to pray for one another, build one another up, encourage one another. Amen. Let's pray. God, we come and we are so grateful that you are a God that established that we do this kingdom work in community. God, we cannot do it alone. And we thank you, God, that you built in your church an interdependence that we might love one another, encourage one another, build one another up, and to pray for one another. Lord, it is your will that every need be supplied, God, and we are so grateful. Now, God, as we come at this time to hear your word, we ask right now, God, that you would help us to focus on hearing from you. God, that you would give us attentive ears and a receptive heart. God, that we might be different. God, we thank you for your word, for your word is what brings life. So God, help us, Lord, to embrace your word and embrace the life change that your word brings. God, we thank you right now. We ask that you just fill us with your spirit and fill us with your word. We thank you right now in Jesus' name. Amen. 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 Give God a hand of praise for you. Amen. 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 I got a little nervous this morning because JB usually sings with the men, and he had on, he was walking down as we prepared for prayer. He's walking down, he had that blue shirt on. Amen. And I had on the blue shirt. I'm like, the men not wearing blue, are they? Amen. He said, no, you say they're wearing white. Amen. So I wore a blue shirt. Michael might threaten me and might make me try to sing. Amen. But I know to stay within my realm, amen. He said, make a joyful noise, amen. But I'm not making no noises today. Amen. Amen. So again, praise God for your presence. We just want to continue to keep our eyes focused on Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith. Amen. Amen. Turn your Bibles with me to James chapter 4. Amen. We don't have to go far. We have been in this series of James. Amen. And we're going to focus our attention this morning on James chapter 4, verses 13 through 17. Amen. So turn your Bibles there, your electronic devices. Turn them there, amen. And please pray for me. My sinus has been kicking up dust this morning. Amen. But I'm going to do what God called me to do. Amen. Start at verse 13, and the Bible reads, come now, you who say today or tomorrow we will travel to such and such a city and spend a year there and do business and make a profit. You don't even know what tomorrow will bring, what your life will be. For you are a bit of smoke. Some of you, your versions may say, you are but a vapor that appears for a little while, then vanishes. Instead, you should say, if the Lord wills, we will live and do this or that. But as it is, you boast in your arrogance. All such boasting is evil. So, for the person who knows to do good and doesn't do it, it is sin. So for the person who knows to do good and doesn't do it, it is sin. These days we are bombarded with reasons to make excuses for our behavior. Amen?
Yeah. Yeah.
It is one of the most convenient defenses we throw out for our behavior is that, oh, I didn't know. We plead ignorance as a defense. Amen? But when it comes to living a committed life to Christ, we cannot claim ignorance. Amen? God's word clearly gives instructions for life. However, many believers choose to ignore God's word, his revealed will, amen, and kind of do their own thing. See, life for the believer boils down to a simple question. Are you going to do God's will or are you going to do your own? Is it your agenda or is it God's agenda? Is it your plan or is it God's plan? Last week we learned about following God's instructions for victory in the daily battle. Amen. We learned that we must first submit to God. That means you must put your will in His hands. Amen. That means you must put your life in His hands. That means you need to fall in order. We learned that that was a military term. Amen. Basically, it means you need to know your role. Amen. And that God is the authority figure. We learned also that you need to draw near to Him. And we learned the fact that in order to draw near to Him, you got to spend time with Him. You can't say you love God, but yet don't spend no time with Him. You can't say you love God, but don't spend time in these love letters He wrote to us. Amen. You can't say you love God, but you're afraid to even hang out and spend time with His people. You must draw near to Him, and we learn as a promise in that as you draw near to Him, He will draw near to you. And then that last instruction we learned was that we must humble ourselves. And if we humble ourselves, He's the one that will lift us up and at the right time. Amen? You don't have to worry about self-promotion. If you're doing what God called you to do, He'll lift you up at the proper time. You don't have to worry about people giving you accolades, certificates, and pats on the back. Amen? Putting your name in the lights. If you're doing what God called you to do and humbling yourself before God's mighty hand, He will exalt you at the right time. Amen? We also came to understand an essential aspect of this battle as believers, that we must resist the devil. Amen? And if we resist him, he will flee. We learned that when we talk about resisting the devil, it's not like putting your hands behind your back and trying to fight. Amen? Resisting the devil is an active work. It is a work that causes us to take action. Amen? Listen, when you used to fight on the block, some of y'all, amen, you would stick your hands in your pockets, amen, because you would have got what? Beat down. Yeah, whooped, amen. You would stick your hands in your pockets. But many of us as believers, we want to fight this battle in our daily walk, but we stick our hands in our pockets. You know how you stick your hands in your pockets? You stick your hands in your pockets by, oh, I'm not going to open that Bible. You stick your hands in your pocket by, oh no, I don't need to pray about that, I got it. You stick your hands in your pocket by saying, you know what, I don't need to serve God. You know, God knows I love Him. He knows my heart. In order to fight the devil, you better have some word. Jesus showed us the perfect example. When the enemy came at him at his weak point, he had been out fasting 40 days, amen, no food, just spending time with God. The devil thought he had it. And when he came up to him and tried to tempt him, Jesus hit him with the word. Amen. Many of us, we're trying to fight, but we don't want to hit with the word. We're trying to hit in our own strength. Amen. And we learn it's a daily battle. It's a daily fight. When we look at James at the beginning of chapter 4, James talks about, again, that war with God. And it ends with talking about the will of God. But the two things are related. When a believer is out of the will of God, he becomes a troublemaker and not a peacemaker. See, when you're out of the will of God, there's no way you can win the battle. Amen? God has called us to depend on Him and to walk in His will. These verses we'll examine today in James chapter 4, 13 through 17. Amen? Serve as a warning to those of us who are determined to do things our own way in our daily Christian life. Instead of what God has called us to do. Amen? If you know what to do and don't do it, the scripture tells us it is sin. For us to know God's revealed will is for our lives to reflect what God's word says. And for us to know His revealed will and to still do what we want to do, we put ourselves in direct opposition to the God of the universe, the creator of the universe. Listen, as one commentator puts it, it's easy for Christians to make plans and goals, amen, expecting God to fall in line with them. It is easy to plan our lives as if we controlled the future and had unlimited authority over all factors affecting our lives. It is quite simple to plan our lives as if God does not even exist. See, James is writing to a believing church that is assuming on God's will. See, many of us, we plan our lives, I'm going to do this, I'm going to do that, amen. And we say, excuse me, God, I need you to bless me. I'm already going this way. I already got my agenda. I already got my things laid out. Now, God, bless it. God is the afterthought, amen. But what we'll find out today is that when you try to plan your own agenda, when you try to plan your own life in open rebellion to God, God is always going to get his way. Amen. He's always going to get his way. In Chuck Swindoll's book, The Mystery of God's Will, he says that the problem with us as we try to understand God's will for our life is that our view is that one that is vertical, that is horizontal and not vertical. He says vertical thinking focuses on the things of God. Vertical thinking focuses on things from a God's perspective. Amen. He says we prefer horizontal thinking, which focuses on the realm of the here and now. Amen. Seeing life as others see life. Dealing with the realities we can touch, analyze, prove, and explain. See, we are much more comfortable with the things that are tactile, familiar, logical, amen. We like the things that are in our culture, that we recognize, those things that are part of our time, amen. See, what vertical thinking, though, it says that we must operate by God's will, by God's plan, by God's purpose. Yeah. Ultimately, he's talking about walking by faith and not by sight, amen. He goes on to say, God offers a better way, and that way always involves faith. Trusting in God's perspective, doing life God's way. Amen? Not our way. Hey, I got a lifetime sentence. I'm doing life. And I've got to do life God's way, not my way. Amen? So as we continue our study and our sermon series, in James, it's only a test. This Sunday, we turn to the subject, do the right thing. Do the right thing. Amen. Y'all, some of y'all been around for a little while. Y'all remember Radio Raheem. Amen. In Spike Lee's critically acclaimed movie, Do the Right Thing. Amen. And y'all remember Spike Lee, Mookie. Amen. Amen. Some of y'all young people don't read it. Amen. It might help. Amen. And do the right thing, we find all up on the hottest day of the year, amen. We find Sal, the pizza owner, amen, owns the pizzeria right in the city, amen. And he is this white establishment, a pizzeria right in the heart of Harlem. And we know that one of the brothers keeps sweating Sal that, hey, why are the brothers on the wall? He has this Hall of Fame of all these Italians. They're like, well, hey, why you let the brothers on the wall? Now put some brothers on the wall. And this, what it does is it starts this racial tension. And we see this racial tension erupt, amen, as Radio Raheem gets choked out and dies at the hands of the police during this incident, amen. And the question kind of, and the thing kind of erupts as Mookie throws a can through the window, a garbage can through the window of Sal's pizzeria, and just, for lack of a better word, all hell break loose. Right. Amen. Y'all know y'all can say hell in church. It's in the Bible. Amen. And the question becomes, as many people ask, well, did Mookie do the right thing by throwing the can through the window? Was he trying to incite a riot? Or was he trying to draw attention away from the people that were beating Sal and his family down? Amen. See, Mookie was faced with a question to do the right thing. Amen. That's what the movie boils down to. Now, we don't have no Mookies in here. We don't have no Sals, and we got a few Radio Raheems. Amen. Amen. But we are all challenged with the question to do the right thing. thing? Will you do the right thing? I believe that these verses show us that we can do the right thing. And when I say do the right thing, I'm talking about doing God's will. We'll find out today that God's will is determined by His Word and by the Holy Spirit. And what we have to do the right thing is we must understand from these verses that you cannot ignore God's will. You must obey God's will. And what's the flip side of obey God's will? Don't disobey God's will. But we'll see it's a little nuanced difference in that. Amen? But before we dive into this sermon, let's talk about the will of God. The will of God. Because many of us don't understand the will of God. Just like Chuck Swindoll, the title of his book, The Mystery of God's Will. Many of us in church, we claim that God's will is a mystery for us. We pray, God, I want your will to be done in my life. Amen. I know your will is good and acceptable and perfect, but Lord, what is your will? See, the Lord's will involves God's plan for our lives, actions, and accomplishments. Amen. When we look at the will of God, it's God's absolute stamp on every portion of our lives. Christians must actively seek this will and do it. It is our goal to seek what it is, what God's will is for our lives. Amen. It is our purpose because we think we know what's best, but truly, Father does know best. Amen. See, we must not merely mount our obedience to the Lord's will as a device to mask our own plans. It is imperative for Christians to earnestly seek God's desires for our plans, our goals, and our actions. Amen? Amen? Many of us, when we sit down and think about, well, what we're going to do, do we truly consider what God's will is? What is God's desire for us? Amen? See, Paul in his writing wished farewell to the Ephesians Christians with the words, I will come back if it is God's will. He indicated to the church at Corinth that he would visit them if the Lord is willing. Amen. We must understand that we must fall in line with God's will. See, our recognition of our dependence on God for the future should not lead us to inactivity, saying that, well, I'm just going to sit back. Whatever God does, God does. Amen. Nor should it discourage us from future planning. What we must plan our future with a seeking of God's will in it. When we commit our plans to Him and seek His will, we can proceed into the future with a conviction that God's grace will sustain us. When we know we're walking in God's will, when we're walking in God's plan, we have the confidence to know that God is going to take us through because He's the one who brought us there. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. So we must learn to do the right thing. We must follow God's will. So the first thing when we talk about doing the right thing, don't ignore God's will. You may have ignored your moms. You may ignore your pops. Young people, you know, even though that's not a good thing, because sometimes that will cost you the belt, cost you some punishment. Amen. But see, us grown folks, sometimes we forget that we have an authority we got to answer to. We cannot ignore God's will. Listen to verses 13 through 14. It says this, come now, you who say today or tomorrow we will travel to such and such a city and spend a year there and do business and make a profit. And he says, you don't even know what tomorrow will bring, what your life will be. For you are like smoke that appears for a little while, then vanishes. Amen. When we look at these verses rebuke our self-sufficient attitudes. Amen. Some commentators feel that James was describing a non-Christian businessman, but the scripture clearly is speaking to Christians who assume on God's will. Hey, I'm going to go roll over here. I'm going to set up shop. I'm going to make some money. We're going to do this. We're going to do that without considering what God desires for you. Amen. Listen, when we look at the Lord's will, we must do everything according to God's will. This was a rebuke James was giving. He was telling them, be considerate of God's will. Amen? Listen, trading was the surest method to make money in first century Palestine in context of our writing. Trading involved risk, but farming was even more uncertain. Amen? A person willing to take risks could become wealthy and live quite independently. Amen? Verse 13 shows us these businessmen planned their time to leave and go make money. They talked about how long they would stay and how much money they would make without any reference to what God was saying. Amen? Jesus tells us in his own words the parable of the rich fool. So some of y'all may remember that parable. The rich man had many barns, amen. It was, his barns were overflowing, amen. He had all this stuff. He said, you know what, hey, I'm going to just build some bigger barns and put my stuff in, amen. I'm good. Said, I'm going to just chill and just enjoy all the stuff that I have done. And the Bible says, Jesus says, what will he do when it says, fool? Today your soul is required of you. Amen. Many of us are living lives like that today. We're kind of ignoring what God has called us to do. And while we're sitting up there, we're lining our pockets. We're doing what we want to do. And we're talking about all this stuff we're going to do. And God is saying, you are a foolish one. You think that's what keeps you? You think it's that your job that what keeps you? You think it's your portfolio that's keeping you? You think it's your degree and your job security, that good state, county job, whatever it may be, that's keeping you? I'm the one that's keeping you. And I can require your life today. We cannot ignore God's will. Amen? Listen to verse 14 one more time. When we look at it, it says, you don't even know what tomorrow will bring, what your life will be. But your life is a bit of smoke that appears for a little while, then vanishes. He says, listen, you don't even know what tomorrow is going to hold. Many of us, we already got our tomorrow planned out. You know, some of y'all, you A-types, amen, you already got your outfit laid out. You already know what the day's going to look like in your mind, amen. You already know how you're going to handle it. You got everything all lined out, and God says, you don't even know. You might not see tomorrow. See, because tomorrow, you don't hold tomorrow. He holds tomorrow, amen. Jesus warns us and said, y'all, why are you worrying about tomorrow? He said, don't worry about tomorrow. Today got enough trouble to live alone. Amen. God says, you don't hold tomorrow. He said, your life is but a vapor. Amen. A puff of smoke. In the light of who God is, in the light of eternity, amen. My dad is 90 years old. He'll be 91 September 11th this year. His life and God's, we look at him, oh, you know, my kid, Papa, lived a long life. He's doing great. Amen. His life is but a poof, a puff of smoke. Amen. In light of eternity that we face, God is like, don't you understand? And what the question becomes, what you do with your paper? Right. How you living out your puff of smoke? Right. Amen. God is saying, you must recognize I'm the one that gives you every ounce of life. Don't ignore my will. Amen. Don't ignore what I called you to do. Trust me. Follow me. Amen. Listen, we do not understand the nature of human life, which is like a mist that appears again for a little while that is gone. Amen. And when we look at a vapor, it is uncertain and it is brief. Life is brief. Amen. Hebrews 9:27 says it's appointed for us, for men to live once and then to die. Listen, we don't know when our appointment time comes. We must make sure we're following God's will for today. And that tomorrow that we want, we got to submit it to Him. Right. Amen. Many of us have busy schedules. It's easy to plan those schedules without considering the will of God. Many of us have all these visionary goals for our business, our job, even our church, amen, our family, about what we're going to do and what we're going to become and all those things. God wants us to work diligently in all those areas, but we must consider His plan first. Right. God, is this what you want me to do? See, some of us have blown past stop signs that God and His will has put up in our lives, amen, and we found our lives in a ditch. Mm-hmm. We're like, oh God, how did I end up here? God, what happened? And God was like, did you see the stop sign? I made it bright and red, amen. And all you had to do was look. And many of us, we looked and saw the stop sign. And we kept on going. And don't ignore God's will, amen. Listen, we count our years at each birthday. And some of us, man, we do some real birthday bashes, amen. But God tells us to number our days. After all, we live a day at a time. And those days rush by quickly the older we get, amen. I mean, listen, some of us, our life seems like a blur as we try to recapture some of those memories. You know, sometimes we get like a picture. We get a picture and we go like, wow, I forgot all about that, because it becomes a blur. Let me tell you this, young people, this for free. You better cherish the moments. I know some of us say, Sade said that, cherish the moments. You saw all this stuff running through my head. Cherish the days of your life, because those days become just a gift, like a vapor. And when God is saying that, you must take it a day at a time, because you're not promised tomorrow. Amen. Listen, since life is so brief, we cannot afford merely to spend our lives, and we certainly do not want to waste our lives. We must invest our lives in those things that are eternal. See, the stuff I invested my life in when I was a lot younger, amen, those things did not have eternal value. That thing, I didn't get no return on my investment. Amen. I come from a line of people, not in my personal life, but I'm talking about in my field. We love overtime. Oh man, let me tell you. Go across the street where the prison I used to work, I mean, love overtime. It's folk ain't seen their families on a regular basis in 10 to 15 years because they're chasing the dollar. Amen. Because, hey, I'm saving up this money so that I can make an investment in my family, so that I can do all this. And they send their kids to college, and they grow up, and they raise their family, and they're like, Pops, I don't even know you. When I was growing up, it was mama at the game, my auntie, grandma, because you was too busy chasing the dollar. See, money disappears. I worked a whole lot of overtime, and I don't see none of that money. Amen. But the greatest value I have is being able to be a part of what God is doing, not only in my life, but in the life of my family. Those things are eternal. Those things that God, you will see the value of those things pay off. All right, not for just now, but for eternity. Amen? Life is brief. God reveals His will for us in His Word. And yet people ignore the Bible. I know folks who say, I want to know what God's will is for my life. I want to know His plan. I want to live right. Or you read your Bible? Well, I want to know what God's will. Are you reading your Bible? No, I really want to know. Well, if you really want to know, read God's Word. Amen. If you really want to know, it's God's revealed will is right there in the Scripture. Amen. This is the instruction book for life. God's Word gives us precepts, principles, promises that can guide us in every area of life. Knowing and obeying God's Word is the surest way of success. So do not ignore God's will. So in doing the right thing, we can not only not ignore God's will, we gotta come, we gotta obey it. Amen. Ignoring God's will is like what the old school church calls those sins of omission. Right. You know, I'm not going to do it. I'm just going to pretend like I don't hear God. But when we look at God's explicit will, we must actively obey it. Verse 15 says, instead of ignoring God's will in your plans, it says this. Instead, you should say, if the Lord wills, we will live and do this or do that. Amen? You may talk to some Christian folk and you think they might be being super spiritual when it says, we don't do this. Hey, God willing. Amen. When they say that, and some of us here, it might be superficial. God willing, we understand that. It's only by God's will.
Right, right,
right. Amen. It's only by God's will. It's many of folk that are not here today that had great plans.
Right.
It's only by God's will. Yes, many people say, oh no, it's no way I ever live in Corona, in the IE, in Riverside. I'm doing this, I'm living here, I'm doing that. God willing. Amen. Listen, when we hear the proper attitude, we are to seek the will of God in all our plans. Doing the will of God demands an active listening for God's goals and plans. We must plan for the future, but we must plan with a deliberate seeking of God's will. If you look all throughout the New Testament, you look throughout the Gospels, you look throughout the letters, you see men and women seeking God's will for their lives.
Right.
Listen, Paul was a man that was totally sold out to Christ.
Right.
Amen.
Right.
Didn't have a great background when it came to that one that you would think would be a Christian. He was a persecutor of the church. Amen. He was one who was highfalutin. The Pharisee was not only just a Pharisee among Pharisees. He had great respect and all those things, amen. But when Paul got saved, his favorite title for himself was, I'm a bond servant. I'm a slave. Not only am I a slave, I'm one that voluntarily put myself in servitude to God. Because I'm going to obey God's word. God's willing, God willing, I'm going to do this and do that. Amen? Again, as we look at the will of God, we must not let his will become a strictly formal expression which lacks any spiritual meaning for us. Like I said, we are good. Let me just share this. In Christianity, we're good at coming up with phrases. You know, we'll throw out, how you doing? I'm blessed and highly favored. God willing. I mean, we got all the little Christianese, but is there any depth behind it?
Right.
Is there any substance behind it? He says, it's dangerous. We can give God lip service. Oh, God, I'm seeking your will as I'm steadily doing whatever I want to do. Amen?
Right.
See, it's a deliberate seeking. It's times that you got to tarry with God. I'm not talking about tarry your friend. That means stay a little while. You got to spend a little time in prayer. You got to stay on your knees a little while. You got to wait a little longer. Amen?
Amen?
And listen, when you look at sports, and I love sports because sports has great analogies all through it. Amen? Some good defenders have to be patient. I don't play quarterback. I've never played quarterback. Amen? That's Billard and Trey and all those other people. Amen? And Art. Hey, I never played quarterback. But if you talk to a corner, they'll tell you patience is a virtue. Amen. You can't get a little overexcited because you see a little something and try to jump around and get an interception. Sometimes you gotta wait to write the proper time. Because if you show your hand, the receiver might change things up. If you show your hand, the quarterback might go another way. Amen. And some of us as believers, we're not patient. We don't want to wait on God. God says, just this job, I got the perfect job for you. You've been praying, you've been waiting, it's coming your way, amen. And you see somebody make you the first offer, yo, that's the job. No, that's it. Did you wait a minute? Is that the one did you spend some time with me? Did you say, God, is this you? But they're saying job. I need a job, God. And God was saying, yeah, they're saying job, but I'm saying that's the job I want for you. And some of us have jumped the gun and missed God's greatest blessing for us. Because we jumped for something that we thought was good and God had something better.
Yeah.
Amen. We have to wait patiently on God and hear from God. Spend time listening to God. Have some depth to it. Amen.
Amen.
We must be those who listen to God's voice and you get, become attentive to God's voice by getting in God's word.
Yes, sir.
Amen. You have to be willing to wait on God. So when we look again at this scripture, instead of us talking about what we will do and how we're going to do it, we must ask God willing. When we look at the promise, it's a prayer promise in 1 John where he says that if we pray anything according to God's will, we have that which we desire. He says we can have confidence in that because we're praying according to God's will. Some of us, we need to be, this is a shout moment right here. Some of us need to be thanking the Lord that we didn't get what we asked for. That'll hit you in the car. You'll get a little moment in the car. That'll hit you later on. And some of us should be jumping and shouting, looking down the aisle. God, thank you.
Thank you.
That you got them out of my life. Thank you, God, that I didn't take that position.
Yeah.
Thank you, God, I didn't move on that street. Thank you.
Yeah.
Yeah. Amen.
Yeah.
Because if I'd have got my way,
yes,
I'd have been in trouble. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Listen, do the right thing involves us, again, obeying God's will. And then, again, doing the right thing says for us, don't disobey God's will. Verse 16 and 17 gives us a different little rub. It says this, but as it is, you boast in your arrogance. And he says, all such boasting is evil. So it is sin for the person who knows to do what is good and doesn't do it. Amen? Listen, these verses reveal our disobedient attitude and rebuke our proud, boastful spirit. They call us to an humble dependence on God, rather than priding ourselves on our independence. Amen. I know what Beyonce said. Amen. That some sisters, y'all got that independence theme. Amen. Listen, God has called us all to be dependent.
Right.
Amen. I know I pulled myself up by my own bootstrap, but who gave you the boots?
Right.
Who gave you the hands to pull your boots up? Amen. We must be utterly dependent on God. He says, when you start talking about what you do, he said, that's boasting, that's arrogant.
Right.
Amen. I'm about to put my kids on blast. We were driving the other day. And you know, and we were rolling and we were talking about their cars. And they were like, we earned these cars. I said, oh, y'all didn't snap back with them. No, don't be wrong. Because I made a deal with them. Amen. I made a deal with them long when they were young. I said, y'all make all A's. You do what you're supposed to do. Amen. I'll make sure when you graduate, I'm going to get you a car. Amen. And I said, a car. Amen. But since they was going off to school in Texas, I wanted to get them something nice, reliable, whatever. Amen. But listen, we earned this. They said, did we not, you know, make the grades and do all this and do that? I was like, y'all kind of bragging and boasting. Amen. But don't we do that with God? God, I went to church. God, I went to Bible study. God, I read your word a few times. Amen. So I'm going to do this. Amen. I give you, you know, I tip you on Sundays. Amen. He said, you're being arrogant. You don't even hold life in your hand. He said, I'm the one that holds your breath in my hand. Your next heartbeat won't be experienced without me. He says, such bragging is arrogant. Amen. He says, don't do it. Don't do it. You got to put your trust in God. You don't hold the future. Amen. But we serve the one who holds the future. Many of us, and I can go around and I can do a roll call of the people who are doing exactly what they said they were going to do with their future. I mean, and I can call a roll, and I guarantee you, all of us in some way have had what we thought were detours. But God had a different plan. Don't boast about what you, I went to school and I accomplished this. I got a doctorate. I got four masters. I got this. I got this. I got that. Paul says all your accomplishments in comparison to what God has done, dumb. You'll find it in the toilet or on the grass somewhere. It's dumb. It's a big heap of stinking. It says God is the one who compelled you and gave you the ability to do what you have done. Amen. It is God who allows you to accomplish those things. It is God that sustains you and keeps you. Amen. Your future is in God's hand. Amen. Don't disobey God's will. Don't brag about what you've done or what you're going to do in the future. Amen. It says all boasting is evil because it says it's about me and not about God. We're utterly to depend on God. When we look at Paul boasted not in his strength. He boasted in his weaknesses. He said, for his weaknesses allowed the power of Christ to rest on him. He glorified in Christ's cross because it was what glorified God. When we give God his credit and put our future in his hand, we bring him glory.
Amen.
Amen. We live in an utter dependence on him. This is a faith walk. When we look at verse 17, some people often kind of misquoted and misinterpreted. Amen. Verse 17 again says, for the person who knows to do good and doesn't do it, it is sin. You know, some people might say, for those of us who know to do better, we should do it. Amen. No, it's saying, if you know to do the right thing, you don't do it, it's sin. Got Paul, James right here, he's not dancing around it. He's not calling it something else. He says, if you know to do the right thing and don't do it, it's sin. See, verse 17 is a very specific principle applied to presumptuous planning about the future. He says, it can also, this is what one person says, it can also serve as a general principle applying to all areas of the Christian life. It is sin to know what is right and to fail to do it. If we don't do the right thing and we know the right thing to do and we don't do it, it is sin. Amen? These sins are showing that we refuse to make the right response to God. Listen, when we look at this, this displeases God. And it is blatant. Many of us have children. And when you give your child an instruction, you go, you might go, Cameron, I need you to do A, B, and C. Cameron acknowledges, Dad, you say, I need to do A, B, and C. And we go, that means communication is taking place. A message has been made, and it has been received. And then when the message does not become carried out, it is a blatant offense to the one who gave the message. Did I not tell you what to do? Y'all know that y'all house sound like, didn't I tell you what to do? Yeah. You told me to do A, B, and C. Well, why are you going to do it?
I don't know.
Oh, I'll do it. We do that to God. God says, you read in my word. I told you what to do. Did you not? Why you not do it?
I don't know. I was doing something else. I was doing something else that was more important. Amen.
Didn't I tell you to get my word?
Yeah, well, you know, I was doing something more important. I had some other stuff to do. What's more important than God?
What's more important than the things of God? What he's saying is that we must follow God's expressed will. When we look at God's will, he reveals it in his word. We cannot ignore the instructions. We have to follow the instructions for life. And what's so wonderful about when we talk about knowing God's will and doing what God has called us to do is that he gives us his word and he also gives us his spirit that dwells in us to give us the power to do it. The Bible tells us, I say it all the time, the Bible tells us you have everything in you to walk in righteousness and godliness because the Holy Spirit dwells and dwells in you. So you're ignoring the God that indwells you. When we say, you know what, God, I know what to do, but I don't feel like doing it. I ain't doing it. Amen. I'm not doing it. Listen, when we look at God's word, God wants us to avoid acts of disobedience. He wants us to do his will. He also wants us to avoid the failure to live up to the truth he has given. The response of the lazy servant which Jesus condemned involved him burying his money and failing to increase it by hard work and effort. Some of you may know, again, that parable that Jesus goes through and he gives all these guys talents and work to do, and they go, some go and they plant and they invest and they reap great harvest, one tenfold, one fivefold. And he talks about the lazy servant. He gave him something. He said, man, I know you a hard taskmaster. So I look, I'll just bury this, sit on it until you came back. Let me knock the dust off it. Here you go. Many of us are sitting on God's investment. God is saying, you know what to do, but you're refusing to do it. Amen. And just like us, when they disobey A, B, and C, amen, a lot of times we may reiterate it once. We may give it to them twice. And then comes out sanctions. Right. Amen.
Right.
And those sanctions go all the way from punishments. Amen. Withholding those things that they like. Amen. Pulling those cell phones, iPads, and all whatever it may be. Then it always goes down to belt therapy. Amen.
Yeah.
Do you know that God has progressive discipline as well?
Right.
Amen. Some of the very things we're struggling with right now is because we've been disobedient to God.
Right.
Because we've refused to do what we already know to do. Amen. Listen, God wants his people to live with a conscious commitment to follow the will of God. We have to do the right thing. And listen, when we do the right thing, it is we must be determined to listen to his word. We must be determined to be attentive to his Holy Spirit. Amen. We must do the right thing. Amen. We must do what we know to do. Listen, I'm going to tell you this. There's some things that God has for our lives. They are a little mysterious. They may be a little hard to understand. But what he's talking about here, do what you know.
Right.
Amen. Do what you know. It's in the Word of God. And let me give you this for free because we got to close. If you have the Holy Spirit dwelling in you, the Holy Spirit does speak.
Right.
Amen. We need to become attentive to his voice. But some of us, we know it's him speaking.
Right.
He's speaking loudly, and we like, shh, can you be quiet? I'm trying to be so loud. We need to follow his word. We need to follow the urging and the guidance of the Holy Spirit. We must do the right thing. Don't ignore God's will. Obey God's will. And make sure we don't disobey God's will. Don't be arrogant, making your own plans. Plan to do what God has called you to do. Let me share this as I close. I remember a time when I used to go to work and my wife and kids were asleep. I come home, my wife and kids were asleep. Amen. Then I got this position where that position didn't have no more opportunities to make money. I'll never forget October 1998. Wasn't no more OT money. And we had a pad for a couple years, amen. Kids were young, and dude, the end wasn't meeting. And I had an opportunity to go teach. We had just got in church, I started getting in Bible study, God really started growing me. And I had this opportunity to teach night school. And night school was on Tuesday nights. And the Bible study that I was in was on Tuesday nights. And I started praying. And I'm like, Lord, you know I need this money. Amen. You know the ends ain't me. And then I prayed, and my friend, hey dude, this night gig is cake. You just come, you know, the pay was right on time. I mean, it was right?
Right.
And I prayed, God told me, don't take it. You make it an investment in your spiritual growth. You need to be there on Tuesday nights. And I'm like, I need this money. And believe me, we struggled financially as a result of that decision. But God kept us. We didn't lose nothing. And we didn't lose our house. Cars didn't get on the tow truck. My kids got fed. Amen. We didn't have the chance to do some of the things that we might have wanted to do. But I had to trust God's will. And I've been in Tuesday night Bible studies for 17 years ever since. Amen. So my challenge to you is, truly listen to God. Because God will sometimes challenge you to do things that are kind of counterintuitive to what you see. But God has a better blessing for you. His will is always good, acceptable, and perfect. Amen. Trust his ear. Trust his heart. Know that he has the best in mind for you. His will is always better than yours. Amen. Amen. Do the right thing. God be praised. Amen.
Too fast and not stopping, forgetting to ask where I'm going. Been crying at night in the darkness, suffering alone in the silence. Been hiding the pain and the confusion, forgetting who holds all solutions. Trying to rule the world my own way. Now I'm humble enough to say that.